We've all seen them. The memes that make so little sense and that are so lacking in a punchline that they're frankly hilarious. In this video, I'm going to be analyzing these memes and why I think they may be the second resurgence of Dadaism. So a while ago, in I think November, I was on TikTok and this video came up on my For You page about generational humor.
When I was your age, we didn't have all these blockbusters and this Facebook nonsense. When we wanted to have fun, we'd go down to the river and we'd throw rocks at the homeless kids. I actually met your mother in a blockbuster. I walked up to her and I said, "Hi, my name's Steve." And she said, "Hi-ya!" Get it? She was busting blocks in a karate dojo. Blockbuster. Some days I wish my crippling depression could be taken away from me like Blockbuster was.
I honestly thought it was hilarious. I can't speak for other members of Gen Z, but I laughed out loud when it was like, block. And I really had no idea why. It certainly wasn't funny in any way that I could explain, and I kind of wondered about why I had laughed, but then I just kept scrolling and kind of forgot about it. Oh my god. Until like maybe a few weeks ago, it just popped back into my mind. I guess it had just been in the back of my brain for months. I have way too much time on my hands in quarantine, so I just was wondering like why that had been so funny to me. While I was thinking about that, I just happened to find this comment on Tiffany Ferg's video, How Vine Shaped a Generation, and things kind of just clicked into place for me, and I've been thinking about that ever since. So let's get into it. Okay, so we're gonna start by doing a quickish overview of what Dadaism was when it was originally conceived. There was a resurgence of Dadaism in the 1960s, which was called Neo-Dadaism, very original. But for the purposes of this video, I'm not going to talk about it. So Dadaism was first conceptualized during World War I by a group of disillusioned artists living in Switzerland who had moved to Switzerland to escape the war. A lot of them were from other countries like France and Germany, and they put on really just insane shows at the Cabaret Voltaire in Zurich. To give you a sense of just how like insane and ridiculous these shows were, I'm gonna read you the first two lines of a poem that was written by Hugo Ball. He performed the poem at the Cabaret Voltaire, and essentially this poem is nonsense. It has no real words in it. All the words in it are made up. So we're just gonna, you know, we're gonna read it. I'm gonna sound like a baby, but it's fine. So here goes. Gadgy Berry Bimba, Glandreedy Lori Loni Kidori. And that's all I'm gonna read because I sound so weird. So the shows, as you saw, were really chaotic and just ridiculous and completely absurd, and they usually didn't make sense. And these artists were doing it basically to mock the people who thought the war was like noble and justified, and also kind of the general faith that people placed in logic at the time. Dadaism ended up spreading to lots of countries around the world, and every country kind of had its own take on Dadaism. For example, Germany's Dadaism was more focused on political protest, whereas in America, Dadaism was more focused on theory. The unifying theme, however, among all of the different groups in different countries was being anti-art, which was the belief that if anything can be art, then also nothing is art, and the subversion of the traditional definition of what art is. This aspect of Dada is encapsulated by Marcel Duchamp, whose art I really don't like, but he's probably the most influential today of the Dadaists. So this dude, Marcel, had a studio in New York, and he filled it with sculptures, depending on your definition of what a sculpture is, which he called ready-mades. And essentially, they were just things that he bought at a store. So he would go to some like store down the street from him, and he would buy, like, a coat rack or a dog comb or whatever, and just, like, said it was art. The most famous of his ready-mades was a urinal that he bought at a hardware store, and he flipped it over, and he signed it R. Mutt, and he titled it Fountain. So the debate was, and still is this art or isn't it? Because he kind of just bought something and then like flipped it over and gave it a name. Does that make it art? The piece ended up becoming a major symbol for Dadaism because of its complete subversion of the definition of art. Because yeah, like he literally just went to the store and flipped over a urinal and was like, that's art. Now that we hopefully all understand what Dadaism was, let's get more into the analysis. I'm going to start by differentiating between absurdist comedy in general and absurdist comedy on the internet. General absurdist comedy is often described as being encapsulated by Monty Python sketches, because it's usually kind of unpredictable and it subverts audience expectations for comedic effect.
Miss Rita Fairbanks, you organized this representation of the Battle of Pearl Harbor. Why?
Well, we've always been extremely interested in modern works. We were the first Transwomen's Guild to perform Camp on Blood Island. And of course, last year we did our extremely popular reenactment of Nazi war atrocities. So this year we thought we'd do something in a much lighter vein.
Well, I can see that you're all ready to go, so I just wish you good luck in your latest venture, the Battle of Pearl Harbor.
Thank you very much indeed, young man.
General absurdist humor often utilizes the irrational or the nonsensical and uses techniques such as non sequiturs, bizarre juxtapositions. Think, for example, how in Alice in Wonderland, the characters were playing croquet using, like, live flamingos as mallets. Like, that kind of thing. Just, like, so weird. In fact, Lewis Carroll's Alice's Adventures in Wonderland was an early example of absurdist humor in literature. Now, let's move on to kind of defining what absurdist humor on the internet is. When I think of those really surreal, absurd memes, the first thing I always think of is that they're usually kind of deep fried. So for anyone who doesn't know what a deep fried meme is, essentially it's a meme that someone has made and they turn up the saturation and the contrast, and they also make the image like really poor quality, like kind of grainy, like a whole bunch of people had reposted it like a whole bunch of times and now it's just like terrible quality. Absurd memes may be edited in other ways other than kind of making them deep fried, like maybe some emojis will be added or some aspects of the image will be distorted, like maybe they'll, you know, blow up a face or like shrink it, and the font that's used is often really generic, like maybe they'll use like Arial or something, or like Cambria. If it's a video, the audio is often kind of distorted and low quality, and also usually there's kind of abrupt loud noises. Sometimes videos also include video clips that are deep fried. Some aspects of absurdist humor carry over from like general absurdist humor to internet absurdist humor. So for example, unpredictability and the subversion of audience expectations are super key to internet absurdist humor and also to just like regular absurdist humor. Also, the memes have to be illogical. They have to be like surreal or nonsensical because that's just what absurdist humor is. And now, let's take a look at some examples of memes that I've seen collected so that you guys get a better idea of kind of what I'm talking about.
You know, the funny thing about Mr. Pibb is that if you pour more than three...
Personally, I find all of those memes, like, really funny. And I suspect that many people in my generation do as well. We'll get more into my theories about why that might be just a little bit later. At the beginning of the video, I said that absurdist memes may be a resurgence of Dadaism, and you might have been wondering why I would suggest that absurdist memes are art. And honestly, maybe they aren't. Maybe they aren't art. But Dadaism also wasn't art in the traditional sense. In fact, two Dadaists, George Gross and John Hartfield wrote that the title artist is an insult and that the designation art is an annulment of human equality. Dadaists didn't consider themselves artists in the traditional sense, just as I'm sure people who make memes don't think that they're artists. They're making content for sure, but whether or not that content is art, it's hard to say because art has no true definition, just as the data is set out to prove. So they both aren't art in the typical sense, but how else are absurdist memes and Dada similar? I would say that the manner in which both movements came about and their audiences are also similar. Dada was created during the First World War to express disillusionment with the way the world was at the time. The Dadaists were critical of the very institutions upon which Western societies rested. They saw how leaders at the time defended the worst war in human history at that point as kind of like a necessary thing and like a noble thing, and how casualties were kind of just brushed off as necessary evils. They saw extreme dehumanization of soldiers as people's lives were kind of just thrown away. And then after the war, they saw extreme inequality during the Roaring Twenties, when some people were getting continuously richer and richer even as exploitation of those in lower socioeconomic classes continued. And they saw the wealth gap widen, and essentially they just lost faith in the prevailing order of society. A while ago, I said that I would explain why I think many people in my generation find absurdist humor so funny. So Gen Z and millennials are living through a similar time as the Dadaists were. And before I start to get into this, I want to say that I'm not saying that all millennials or all members of Gen Z are on the same page about what I'm going to be talking about, just as not everyone agreed with the message that the Dadaists promoted in their art. And while some of the points I'm going to make apply everywhere, some apply more to the United States and kind of the West. My generation is growing up in a time when we're starting to see the full effects of climate change, and many of us are fighting against the established capitalist order, which has financial interest in continuing to pollute, and we see just a grim future for our planets and ourselves. We live in an era also of extreme political divisions and little rhetoric between both sides. We see the wealth gap widen continuously and little being done about it. In fact, I read the other day that Jeff Bezos is set to be the world's first trillionaire by 2026, while millions of people are losing their jobs in the pandemic and he's working his employees to exhaustion. I don't know. It doesn't sit well with me. And it doesn't sit well with a lot of other people either, because recently I've seen a lot more people being critical of the established capitalist order and the excess of wealth that the 1% has. I would say that there is a large group of people who are just completely fed up with how things are because the institutions upon which society rests have failed them, just as they failed the Dadaists like 100 years earlier. And we've collectively turned to absurd and surreal humor to cope with it, to cope with our disillusionment with how things are. We're confused with how the world is, and we've turned that confusion around, and like the Dadaists once did, we're replacing logical nonsense with illogical nonsense. thereby embracing and parodying our own confusion. Finally, Dada was a movement. It was embraced by people across the globe and spread relatively quickly for the time period that it was conceptualized in. People all around the world, in different countries and different cultures, who speak different languages, all have access and may enjoy absurdist memes because of the internet and the connectivity that it provides. As Dadaism spread across the world, it was described as a virgin microbe because of how quickly it spread and how many people were involved. And I gotta say, if Dada was a microbe, then absurdist memes are like drug-resistant airborne bacteria because they reach just so many people, like millions. So whether absurdist memes are art in themselves, they certainly reflect the sentiments of the generation that embraced Dada. They have similar themes and motivations, and they both became cultural phenomena which permeated the collective consciousness at the time. And I know that as absurdist memes have been around, they've continuously gotten more and more confusing and more common at the same time. And whether or not you agree with anything I've said, I can say with the utmost certainty that if the Dadaists were around today to see absurdist memes, they would be proud.